to see past what is just directly in front of me.
Okay. That's good. That's good. That's a seeing beyond. That is a form of discernment. That's good. All right. All right, y'all. Let's go. Let's go. Look, come on. Let's go this morning. Now, what is it that you see that you have the ability to be able to do? Let's go.
I have the ability to hear and see in the spirit.
Amen. That's something that God has granted. Awesome. Awesome.
That no matter what man or anybody tell you, that you realize that I realize that he has the last say so.
Amen. That's good. That's good. That's good. All right. Anybody else on the line? Go ahead. Somebody was trying to say something. I can't hear you.
I have the ability to be able to operate in a prophetic realm. I'm allowed to see things over people, and I also have the ability to go in and intercede and to be at warfare for others as well.
Amen. Amen. That's good. That's good. Anybody else? What is it that you see that you have the ability to be able to do? What have you noticed about yourself?
I also noticed that some tongues I can understand.
Okay.
And also some, I've seen some, like, the demonic, like, faces that some people carry that has came in the midst of us. It's like I was able to see, like, their face, the demonic face.
Mm-hmm. Awesome, awesome. That's discernment. That's good. That's good. That's good. That's good. That's good. Prophetic people and intercessors carry strong discernment. They carry strong discernment, but they have to. Prophetic people and intercessors carry strong discernment. They carry more of a discernment than pastors. They carry more of a discernment than evangelists. They have to have the spirit of discernment. Most of the time, that's what they possess, is the spirit of discernment, not the gift of discernment. The gift of discernment can be on a pastor. The gift of discernment can be on an evangelist. But those prophetic people and those intercessors are more than likely going to walk in the gift of discernment, because it is predicated on their ability to be able to move like God wants them to move. It is predicated on the fact that they got to know what they're dealing with. They got to know how to call a spade. They got to know that if that's a jack, that's a jack. They got to know if that's an ace, that's an ace. They can't be saying, well, I think it's a jack. I mean, I'm not really sure. I don't know. They cannot function like that, because if they function like that, they're going to throw off sync everything that God wants to do when God is counting on them to get the job done. He has given them a specific assignment to get the job done. If you are an intercessor, and all of you that are under my voice are, then there is specific assignments that God has given you for you to have done. Now, not all of you are prophetic. Some of you are, but there is specific assignments that God has given for you to do, and therefore you must have what you need in order for you to carry out the assignments. You cannot be an intercessor and be stumbling and fumbling. You cannot be a prophetic intercessor and be stumbling and fumbling. A prophetic intercessor is going one that is going to intercede about what God wants to do in the future. Now, you just think in your natural mind for a second. Come out the spirit. Think in your natural mind. Do you want somebody speaking over your future that don't know what they're talking about, that's fumbling and bumbling all over words and stuff? Do you want that? How would you feel about that?
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
They put me in a place. They've been having me off in a ditch.
Yeah. You want a certainty. You don't want them saying, I think, you know, in 2025 that something is going to come. I'm not sure, but I think that, you know, this is going to happen. And no, you want a certainty. You want someone that says, the Lord has told me that in 2025, we're going to experience blah, 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 blah. And this is going to happen, such and such. See, that is of a certainty. You want someone that is sure, you know, of what, you know, that they can raise their hand if they're sure. You want somebody like that. You don't know. No. So it is important that you know exactly what it is that God has given you the ability to be able to do. Because if you know of assurance that God has given you, granted you the ability to do this, you will walk thereof. You will walk therein. So that's what the scripture says. When you find the path, it says, you walk therein. So it is something that you will come upon, for something that you are seeking and something that you are desiring. And when you find it, you are to walk therein. Don't you move off of it. You stay right there on that course. Don't you allow anything to cause you to deviate off of it. You stay right there on that course. Now, are you going to have opposition on that course? Sure, you're going to have opposition. Why am I going to have opposition? I'm going to make it plain for you. When they went to go see, the Bible says in Job 1, when the sons of God presented themselves to God, that Satan came also. That's in Job 1. You will see Satan came also. So you can't get misinterpreted or misconstrued of thinking that because I've made it onto the path that I'm not going to have opposition. Yes, you are. The biggest thing that you're going to fight against when you have made it onto the path is your mind, because everything comes from the cerebral cortex, which is the mind. So the mind is going to go under a substantial amount of attack. It is very important and vital that we treat our minds and we make sure that our minds stay in a good place, because if the mind does not stay in a good place, you're going to be off skilter with whatever it is that you're doing. And this is what the enemy wants. If God says, I live on 134 running up to 189. If the Lord says, go up to highway 189 and take a left. Perversion of the mind, which is twisted. That's what perversion means, is twisted. So perversion of the mind would say, oh, maybe it would, may tell me to go to 189, but it's going to tell me to hook a right. You know, it's going to take me away from what it is that God has said for me to do. It's going to take me in just a little leaven to leaven the whole lump, because now I'm going in a wrong direction. I'm on 189. I'm on highway 189, but I'm going towards Kinston when I should have been going towards Elba, which is the way the Lord has set for me to go. So it is very vital that we understand that the mind has to be in a good state. The mind has to be in a good place. There are certain things that you have to do to make sure that you take care of your mind. This is for every one of y'all, to make sure that you take care of your mind because of the assignments that have been placed on your life. Mess around and let your mind get off track. Mess around now and let yourself get off kilter. It's going to get ugly. It's going to knock off everything. It just takes everything off sinks and put everything off balance. You've got to watch your mind. That is the biggest battle that you are going to fight with, is watching your mind. You're not even going to fight as hard with hearing God. That won't be the biggest issue, but you're going to fight with the fact of obeying God and carrying out the assignment of God. Now, Adam and Eve, I'm going to show you in scripture what I'm talking about. Adam and Eve heard God when he said, don't touch this fruit. Adam heard him and Adam conveyed it to his wife. Let me tell it like it really is. Adam heard him. The instruction was given to Adam and Adam conveyed it over to his wife. So they heard, they knew what not to do. They even knew what the results of it was going to be, what the penalty of it was going to be. They already knew every bit of that and how it was going to be. But now, and because of them knowing this, which means you can hear But the issue is going to be carrying out the assignment. That's what the problem is going to be. You will hear God say, I want you to do such and such. You will. How many of y'all would tell the truth about it this morning? I'm on a truth gig this morning. I put a post on Facebook a while ago about people being honest and telling the truth. How many of y'all will tell the truth? This is what I posted. How many of y'all will tell the truth and say sometime you let the devil use you? Huh? How many of y'all? So listen, how many of y'all are willing to tell the truth that you heard God, but you don't always obey God?
Amen. That's facts.
You be done heard God tell you, get that woman that dress. Shoot, you put the dress back in the closet. You be done heard God say, sow that seed, you go on about your business. You be done heard God tell you to stop somewhere and you keep driving. You be done heard God. See, the issue is not the fact of fighting what you hear. The issue is fighting you to obey what you hear. That is the issue, to obey what you hear. It makes me think about how I was driving up to going towards Dothan, and I won't ever forget the location. I was right there by Larry's Barbecue. I was on the phone with Quincy. Quincy had bought Quinn back to me, and all, you know, I'm praying for our family to reconcile. He bought Quinn back, but he didn't bring himself back. And I asked him, I said, well, when you coming back? He said, I ain't ready yet. See, the thing of it is he had heard, but he wasn't willing to obey. And how many times have we heard God? We know the right thing to do, but we just not willing to obey it. We're not willing to carry it out. We know it's wrong. We know that we shouldn't do that, or we know we should do that, but we just gonna still go ahead and do what it is that we define. We gonna still do what it is that we want to do, you know. And so, and that is so when you have these callings on your life, and every one of you have callings. I don't deal with people that don't have callings on their lives. You know, every one of you have a specific call on your life. You are more than just a pew warmer. That's the reason why you ain't in church, because you are more than just a pew warmer. See, if you was a pew warmer, you'd be sitting in a church right now about to get the same little message that they get every week with a little at the end of it, and then they go home and get right into their same stuff. But see, you're not a pew warmer. You are a life changer. You are called as a mountain mover. You are a history maker. So you have been called to break generational curses off of your family. You have been called to do the first thing that's ever been done in your family. You are the first one that will break the back of the enemy. You are the first one that will destroy all the admonition that the enemy has used for generations. You are that one. And because of that, you are not in church. You are the one that will pray over your cities. You are the ones that will see what's going on and shut it down and stop it from happening. You are the one that when your feet step in a place, it shifts the whole atmosphere. You are the one. You are that one right there. And if you don't know you are that one, then you will still steady succumb to the tricks and the deception of the enemy. You won't walk in the fullness of who you are and what you have the capability to do. You will always be beat down. You will, listen, let me tell y'all something. I need to say this right here. Now, I'm going to say this because I hear the Holy Ghost telling me to say this. At the point of death, I need y'all to hear me well, because if I'm not missing God, I'm about to say what God wants to be said. But if I'm missing God, I'm going to repent for it. Okay, listen. At the point of death, there may be certain things that the body suffers, you know, goes through at the point of death. Because death can be gruesome, so to speak. Now, it doesn't have to be that of a Christian. A Christian can just, you know, peace out, that type of stuff. But at the point of death, there will be, that's an end. Death is an end. It is an end of natural life. It is an end. If you are going through things in your body that signifies death, and you know it's not time for you to die, then you are under some type of curse. You are not fighting like you should fight. You are not standing in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. and you've allowed yourself to be entangled in some yoke of bondage. There's more than likely word curses that are over you that you have not gotten over you, and there are things about you that you need to be delivered of. I'm on this gig about taking y'all through some deliverance, because the Lord done told me, including myself, but y'all need to be delivered. Y'all got some stuff that's still attached to y'all that you need to be delivered from. And if you don't get delivered from this stuff, it's them little foxes that is going to spoil the vine. It's that little hidden stuff that you think I don't know nothing about, but that I'm real quiet about, but I see it in operation because I've been called to snuff it out. And I see it. And I guarantee you, I'm probably not ignorant of what you're doing. Backdoor tipping, all that kinds of stuff like that. Dealing with men, all that kinds of stuff. Think I don't know about what's going on. Know about every bit of it. Sitting there, miles running more than what they should. Every bit of it. See all of it, because I'm not ignorant concerning those things, because I'm an intercessor for one. And, you know, and so it's going to sharpen the discernment of what I have with things. But I'm telling you, if your body is experiencing death-like things, death-like symptoms and all this type of stuff, you need to be delivered. You better hear what I'm telling you. I don't care how much you speak in tongues. You got some stuff that needs to be delivered out of you. You got some things that need to be destroyed off of you. You better understand that. There is levels to this thing, y'all. There is levels to this. And what takes that stuff off of you is sitting under the word of God, and it is committing yourself to a righteous way of life, and that stuff has to fall off. There are things that have fallen off of me that I started with when I first got saved, and they were still on me. See, salvation is confession, but it does not mean that everything drops off of you. There are some things you got to till the soil to go after. You got to look at that thing and say, now my mama and them did that, and I ain't finna do that mess right there. That right there, that come from my daddy them side. I ain't finna do that. See, some stuff you got to denounce, and some things you just got to purge yourself off of. If you have gotten saved, and I'm gonna give you an example. If you have gotten saved and you are a person that has had multiple partners, which means you slept with more than one to two men, and all you've had multiple partners, and you got saved and you asked the Lord to come into your life and to feel you, you know, and that type of stuff. And the Lord comes in and does that. But you got to understand what the Bible tells you that has to happen. It says that the house has to be cleansed. That means your confession is what opened the door for him to come in, but he still got to take his broom. He still got to take his mop. He still got the dust. He still got to disinfect, baby. So because all that stuff is sitting in there, you just gave him permission to the house. There are some things that need, y'all don't understand me today. There are some things that I'm about to tell y'all, I'm serious. Y'all can think I'm playing, you probably, if you want to. I'm about to go at some stuff in deliverance because I, for one, I'm sick of it. Number two, I know it's a great hindrance to you getting to where you want to be. Even in my life, I'm watching and looking at things and looking for stuff. See, I'm a wheel watcher, as they say. I'm a wheel watcher. Yeah, I'm a wheel watcher. I be watching to see, what is this right here that's keeping me from money, like I supposed to have money? What is this right here that's attacking my body? Because I ain't got time to be sick. I ain't dead yet. Death ain't my portion yet. So because death is not my portion yet, I'm not fishing to let my body sit there and be afflicted and suffer like it's about, boom, to die. Now get back from me. I'm not fishing to let that. I refuse to even let that come in my environment. It ain't surrounding me. The devil is a lie. That's why I stay away. Because I can't do that. It ain't time for me to die yet. And I ain't fishing to let my body tell me that it's time either. You going to get up. You going to move like you supposed to. And you going to live until you die. I'm not going to be alive and dead. I'm going to live until I die. I don't think y'all heard me. I'm going to live until I die. I'm not going to be alive and dead. I'm going to live until I die. And that's what's going to happen. So you have to be careful, because there is so much that goes on, and there is so much that comes, and these things are coming because of the power that you possess. When you confess Christ, Christ still got to come in and cleanse the house. That is the reason why even years later, after you, having done confessed Christ, and even years later after you done been with me, and it seemed like, wow, some of you may be thinking, dang, I can't never get nothing right. Every time I turn around, she getting at me about something. I thought I was doing better. Listen, let me tell you what that is. That is the stages of deliverance. That's what it is. You can't ever think that you got it all together. No, you don't. You don't have it all together. There are stages to deliverance. There is some things that we catch right now, and then there are some things we'll catch a little bit later. In time, it will reveal that. I want y'all to always remember that. In time, it will reveal. But when it's spoken, whenever you are confronted about something, that's the time right there for deliverance. I wish y'all heard God this morning. When you are, God help me, when you are confronted, when you are confronted about something, that's when God is ready to deliver you. When it's mentioned, when it is brought into the light, that is now time for deliverance to come. It is now time for things to come, for things to work out, for things to shift for you. It is now time for that. God will bring it up because he's ready to bring it out. I'm going to tell you that three times. God will bring it up because he's ready to bring it out. God will bring it up because he's ready to bring it out. And so he'll start dealing with you about it, or something will come up and it's noticed. It's caught. It's noticed. It's caught. It is noticed. And anytime, I give y'all another secret, another nugget for you to know. Anytime multiple people seeing the same thing about you, watch out. Watch out. Don't you dare walk off thinking they don't know what they're talking about. That's a lie from the pits of hell. Even if you have not manifested what they have, what they're seeing, it means that something is about to come to make you manifest it. So you best to be on guard, baby. You best to be watching on every corner, because something is about to come to make you manifest it. If they say, listen, if two, three people say, listen, I saw you robbing a bank. Don't get it. Listen, don't go to no banks. Stay away from banks. Don't go to no banks. Get somebody else your card to go get some money. Don't go to the bank. Don't go to the bank. Don't go to the bank. Don't do it. Don't do it. Them folks done prophetically saw what's heading your way. And you think, I ain't robbing no bank. I ain't even thought nothing about robbing no bank. You ain't thought nothing about it today. But you don't know what tomorrow holds. And they done prophetically saw this. And they done come forth as a prophetic intercessor, exposing what it is that they saw. And you don't even understand that there is a tendency on the inside of you. There is a tendency on the inside of you and a potential for you to do that. Oh, I wish y'all heard me this morning. I wish y'all heard me this morning. There is a tendency and a potential on the inside of you to do it. Whatever it is that is being called out, that's being acknowledged, it is. Y'all done left me by myself this morning, ain't you?
No, ma'am.
It was seen because it's there.
You didn't try to say no, and it wouldn't even go, but no, ma'am, you ain't by yourself.
It was called out because it's there. It's there. The smartest thing that you can do is govern yourself accordingly. That's the smartest thing that you can do. They saw you robbing a bank. Don't go to no banks. Don't go to no banks. They saw you in the bed with somebody. Don't be buying nobody by yourself. See, those are smart things. That's wisdom. Because, you know, instead of thinking, I ain't even thought nothing about no man. I ain't even thought about being in no bed with no man. No, you ain't thought about it today, but you don't know what's set up for you tomorrow. You don't know what's set up for you tomorrow. So you gotta be careful. You gotta be careful. And understand there is more levels to deliverance than what you've already experienced. Anything about you that is contrary to the word of God, that part needs to be delivered. I'm going to say it again for you to hear me. Anything about you that is contrary to... I wish somebody heard me this morning. It's like I should be preaching to the world today. Anything that is contrary to the word of God is something that needs to be delivered. Well, I know God don't want me laying around whoremongering. You need to be delivered. I know I shouldn't be stealing from God and not giving like I should. You need to be delivered. I know I shouldn't be sitting around gossiping, talking about people with my family and stuff. You need to be delivered. Okay, y'all got me by myself again, don't you? I feel y'all when y'all leave.
Man, I ain't living.
You need to be delivered. That's all the anything that's contrary to God. Now I want y'all to be honest this morning. I done told y'all I'm on this honest gig this morning, baby. Ooh, I'm on this honest gig. I don't know what's going on with me. On the 21st, I usually don't even be in this type of situation that I'm in right now. I usually be like this from the 1st through the 10th. But somebody done sent something in the realm or something at me. Then they had me hot as a firecracker around here today. That's my honesty. That's my honesty. So I need y'all tell the truth about somewhere you need to be delivered. I just told mine.
I there's an element of perversion and a whorish nature. Ain't did anything, but it's there, and I can see, and I know it's there, and it's like I have it mastered, because I can feel when it's bubbling, and it does it at just particular times.
Okay, we got one confession. Would it be another? We're doing the auction, man. Would it be another?
My attitude, man, ain't the best. And, it's a sense of control there as well.
I second that with an element of control for myself.
Okay.
And attitude.
Well, I'll say pride. Pride, because control is a form of pride.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? Would there be another? Where do you need to be delivered at? Are you perfect? Because if you perfect, I need to turn the camera on you.
I definitely agree with attitude being one of my attitude towards things. My temper being one. My temper is absolutely horrible. You know, even in my adult age, I'm still like 0 to 100, you know, just ready to fight. And I don't want to be like that person, because it takes so much to, you know, calm down from that. Like, my temper is just horrible. I struggle with making the correct financial decisions. I struggle with patience. It's so easy for me to see and hear the goodness over other lives, but it's so hard for me to believe that it can happen to me, no matter how many times I fall on my face, no matter how many times I go in the tone, no matter how much I stay in worship, no matter how much I stay in my work. I can feel good for that moment, but you know what? When it don't turn around and happen, where am I? I'm lost. I'm discombobulated. Like, just, I struggle with staying in a healthy mental state of things. there are some other things, but those are ones that come to mind off top. Mm-hmm.
There's a strong spirit of poverty fighting you. Okay. Anybody else?
Mine is my attitude. It can be nonchalant at times, where I can get phone calls and it's like people are getting into me, stuff that they're doing, and I'm being judgmental. And instead of praying about it, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, well, that ain't got nothing to do with me. If they hadn't done this, that, or other, then this, that, or other wouldn't occur. And attitude adjustment I need.
Okay. All right. Anybody else among us?
Yeah. Angela, how y'all doing today? Yeah. I have problems with my attitude at times, and I also need to be delivered from self-inflicted wounds, such as blaming myself for stuff that's happening to other folks because they don't listen to me. That really bothers me.
Okay. Well, I took a course this past week, y'all, on anger management, because it sounds like all y'all need it.
Okay.
Y'all need to sign up for Free to Be Me. Y'all know y'all get it half off.
I was just gonna say that part of I don't do the separation like push it back, but boy, I be mad as hell. I ain't even gonna lie.
Shit.
I think you going over some of the anger management things the other day that I didn't know I was angry about some stuff. I really didn't. And just hearing you talk about it, I was like, oh, snap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I took anger management.
It's the unreleased stuff that you have on the inside. Like you said, when you don't know you're mad about stuff, it's the stuff that's really on the inside. Some of you know about, but you know that it's a lot of stuff on the inside of us that we just are unaware about it, but it still harbors in us. And because we're unaware about it, we can't correct it, but it's on the inside of us. And with it being on the inside of us, it still takes a toll and eats at us, and it reflects in how we act in our everyday lives as well, too.
That's the reason why it is imperative that we go through deliverance, and deliverance not be just a one-time thing. It has been of the persuasion in the church that once you go to the altar and get saved, like the slate is wiped clean, and that's not true. That's not true. That is allowing God into the house, but he's still now got to garnish the house. He's got to cleanse the house to get the house where he needs it to be. And if you think about it, all of us have places in our house that we tend to keep off limits. We may let you only as far as the living room, but we don't want you in the bedrooms. You know, we may, you know, it's certain things about us. Like, for instance, my guest bedroom and my guest bathroom, I am a fool about those two being clean. Now, mine will be tore up from the floor up back there. But them right there, uh-uh. Because, see, I want them clean for the guests to come in to see. When actuality, all of it should be of the same caliber. So all of us have things that we, you know, we prioritize. And that's why deliverance is a must in going through the stages of continual deliverance. So, like, my mind, you know, I'll show y'all what I'm talking about. Fussy is out here. He's in that guest room sleep. He done went in that bathroom. When me and him got in this morning for a day, he went in that bathroom. And now he in that room sleep. My mind already this morning done said, I'm finna wash them sheets. I'm finna clean up that bathroom. Now, he ain't said it about my room. But it done said it about this, and the boy's still in there right now. You see, because that's how, you know, depending on where you are mentally, you know, as it relates to something. And it will tell you the type of person that you are. Let me show y'all from personality-wise. I think, Toya, I think you was trying to say something. Hold it for a second. Let me tell y'all something personality-wise. I'm going to show you something. that show you either that way for one of two reasons, like what I'm describing with myself. You're either that way because of image, which means you want it to look good for other people. You're worried about what somebody is gonna say. Or either you want it to look good for other people. Now, that is my position. I want it to be good for other people. I want you to sleep in a clean, good smelling bed and use a bathroom that is clean and sufficient. So it is for the people. So you have to discern and decipher where your motive comes from. Now, prior to me getting to where I am, it used to be for the first reason. I didn't want nobody saying anything, because until you convert your life over to Christ for real, real, you live based off of image. You're just that's just human nature. The flesh dominates the spirit, and you live from the outside in rather than from the inside out. So I used to have that. So I'm not going to tell y'all that I didn't. I used to do it because I didn't want nobody talking about it, you know, worried about how it's going to be. Now I do it for people. I do it for a guest if a guest comes, because I want the guest to sleep very good. I want the guest to feel at home. It ain't me worrying about whether they're going to go out and say, well, you know, the VNs, I don't even think like that. I don't even care, because it's for you now. So you have to look at your position of where you are. And with all of the things that y'all were calling out about yourselves, I'm going to go ahead and tell you the truth. You're not locked in the spirit as much as you should be. You're not living out of your spirit as much as you should be. I get mad, but I only get mad a few times. Usually it's like 2 times a year. I don't know how I ain't been able to stop it. 2 times a year, like a serious pissed off. I hadn't been able to master stopping that. But when you live consecrated and you do the best that you can to live submitted to the Spirit, it pulls you out of those places. Now, it's not to say that you won't go there sometime, because you can, you know, you can. But it pulls you out of those places. It's not a place that you live. And that is something that you have to deal with, the internal affairs of yourself. You got to get rid of that mess soon as it hits. I'm talking about really, really fast. You got to get rid of it quick. You got to forgive. You know, I'm not lying to y'all. At the first of this coming month, August, the first through the third, that fast that we get in on with Tiffany Montgomery now, the title of that fast this time is Forgive Fast. Forgive Fast. I want to encourage y'all to do the first 3 days of this month of August. Don't play with it, please. Get that fast in to get that kill. Now, that is a revelation, but it is one that I have been had. I will get that mess off me quick. Because I know if I don't get it off of me quick, what it does is it lodges on the inside. And then the Bible says it starts going into the marrow of the bones. And when it starts hitting the marrow of the bones, it starts causing a deformity, which is this arthritis and all, and pains and aches in the bodies. That is a lot caused by things that we harbor that we won't release and we won't let go. It is a harboring of things, because to be honest with you, the body was designed to filter itself, which means that's why waste comes out of us, even though we eat things that we shouldn't. Not a whole lot of it gets lodged into our bodies to remain there, because the body has systems put in place in order to cleanse itself. You're going to pee, and some of it's going to come through the urine. You're going to have a bowel movement, and some of it is going to be released out of the bowel movement. But the things that cannot be released are those things that we refuse to let go of, which is like being pissed off at somebody, which is like holding on to, some type of grief. Grief is one that will just lodge on the inside, because what grief comes at, one of the root causes of grief is anger. It's mad. It looks to people like a sadness. Now I'm gonna play on your eyes now. So just go ahead and chill out for a second. I'm finna put a play on your eyes and a play on your mind. Just show you the real nature of the truth of it. There are root causes to things, and we are surface people. We tend to just look at the surface. We don't look at the root, you know. But I got to go beyond that and get to the root of why did I want to knock that woman out, God? Well, Delphine, you said this, that's the root of it. Okay, then. So if you destroy the root, you stop the fruit. So grief, the root cause of grief is anger, being mad. And it looks like it's a sadness, because, you know, you'll see the tears and that kind. And see, we automatically, just when we see tears, we automatically associate that with sadness. They must be sad. No, listen, if there is a person that has someone that is everything, does everything for them, always making a way for them, always, whenever they come through, they done messed up their money, they ain't living like they supposed to, paying their bills like they supposed to, but this person comes through for them and catches their slack all the time, you know, always looking out and watching out for them, but then all of a sudden God calls that person home. Most people would think that is a sadness, that individual is dealing with. Oh, they just so sad, you know. Oh, but no, them folk get mad. Them folk get mad because now they finna have to pay their own bills. Now they finna have to try to figure this thing out called life when they done have this individual figuring out everything about life. They are mad. And so then that's when they start being mad with God. Why did you do that? Well, why did I do what? Why did you take my crutch away? Away from me. Why did you take that away from me? You know, how could you do that? And see, that is the danger of not having a mind of your own. That's how that's what it'll do. That is the danger of not having your own thoughts, see, and not knowing how to articulate your own life and your own path and your own destiny, and having it caught up into someone else. That's what happens. And so it comes forth grief, you know. They think that they sad. No, they ain't. Let me tell y'all something. People, I want y'all to watch this from now on. Anybody that y'all see that pass away, I want y'all to pay attention. I want you to watch your families. Watch anybody where you see any type of death that takes place. Watch to see how those people respond. To see those people that those folks was so dependent on those people that did not have their own minds, they finna be tripping. They finna be tripping. But when you, the ones that have their own identity, they live with a missing. You know, they miss the presence of the person, but they understand, like the song says, and the beat goes on. And the beat goes on. They realize that there is a complete difference. I just released something just then. I felt it when it left. That thing left out my spirit when I did. Did y'all understand what I just said? That thing left my spirit.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I'm telling, when I tell you that thing, somebody got that. I felt it. It left my spirit. Ooh. Yeah. Yeah. Mm. man, I'm talking about it pulled straight out my spirit. Right straight through the belly button area. Just shoop, that's how it came out. And it went where it needed to go. Because his word won't return to him, boy. So pay attention and watch. You'll be able to see, y'all. Bet you watch it from now on. You'll be able to see. So, you have to be careful. You have to be mindful. And understand that deliverance is not just a one-time thing. And don't be ashamed of deliverance, okay?
What I was going to say, let's go, is like, just literally, like, get myself into a place where I think for myself, as in things that I want, like, whatever. And going through this process is like, okay, are you doing this because you mad as hell, because you couldn't do it from the beginning? Or are you doing it because this is something that you really want to do? Mm-hmm. And even sitting around just thinking about that, it literally makes me like, hold on, don't you make no decision right now? Because literally, it's like one day I went through and I started trying to change up everything in here. Because it was like, you be held back. Not you be held back. Daniel did not like things changed. He don't want you to change to come. He'll let you change. He don't like things to be, you just leave it like it is. You can change the comforter and stuff. You can do like maybe a curtain, but anything else is like, no, unless he wanted to. And I was like, man, I always wanted to change this. I always wanted to put the picture here. I always wanted to do that. So in the midst of that, it let me know, girl, you see, he have a temper tantrum. You sitting around here talking about, I always wanted to do this, so I'm going to do it. No. Sit your tail down, really. You better make sure that this is something that you really want to do. You're not acting onto something that is nobody's no longer here. He can't say nothing anyway because he's not here. But literally, is this something you really want to do? Or are you doing this because you couldn't do it before? Or really, what is it that you're trying to do? Why? Is it that you're just trying to put on, like, okay, oh, she didn't change everything in the house. Even that crossed my mind, but it did not cross my mind, and that's the way of me doing it. But it's like, you make sure you evaluate everything, because at one point, now, you did stuff just for other people. You dressed a certain kind of way so other people would accept you. Okay, what are you doing this for? Literally, look at everything that you're doing, and that you're doing this because this is something you want to do, or are you doing this for other people? And it's literally making me evaluate everything that I do. I mean, everything.
The stages of it is pride at first. There is an element of pride, you know. And when I say pride, there is an element of pride that says, you stopped me, but you can't stop me now. So I'm going to do what I want to do. That's typical. Everybody hits that stage. Everybody. The first stages of any type of separation, breakup, divorce, death, the first stages of it is pride. It is just like, if y'all remember this, I keep things very simple. If y'all just pay attention and watch, walk this stuff out in your life, you won't be in situations so tough. There's three stages to life. You got Egypt, which is pride. You got the wilderness, which is the stripping away. And you got Canaan, which is the promised land. You're gonna go through those three stages in all that you face, especially in anything where there is an end to, you're going to go through those phases. You're in this stage, the first stage of pride, and that is, nigga, you ain't here now to tell me what to do. You can't run this now. I want that picture right there. Put it right there. I wish he would say something. You and through that, you know, and the anger part, because of certain things that you realize. See, in the pride stage, you start realizing a lot of things that you did not see because of blinders. So in the pride stage, which is the first stage, you start realizing, oh my God, this is what Israel went through. In the first stages, which is the pride stage, which is Egypt, they start realizing, dang, Pharaoh was working the hell out of us for nothing. Jesus Christ. He had us making bricks. Wasn't he paying us good? Had us working for the man every night and day. From sun up to sundown. He had us working like that. And then gave us the scraps off of the hogs, the scraps off of the cows, and we had to learn to make good meals out of it. But they didn't realize that until coming out of it. Because as long as they were in it, they were blinded by it. So they were just taking the parts of the pig and they were, you know, eating it, because basically, this is all that I can, this is all I got, ain't nothing else I can do. So they just indulged in it. They dealt with it. When they came out of Egypt, they looked back and seen, wait a minute. Hold up, Israel was using us. Now, second part is the wilderness, which is the place of stripping. The place of stripping is the place of deliverance. The deliverance can become so intense when you're having to get free from something that it'll want to drive you back to what you were in. That is why they start saying it had been better that you just left us over there. Because this hard. I got to do what? You got to fast. I got to fast. Yep. You got to submit. I got to submit. Yep. You got to be honest. I got to be honest. Yeah. Well, I don't want this then. Just take me on back over there. Well, I didn't have to do all that. I got three hearts and a cot over there with Pharaoh. Take me back over there. See, it all depends on your level of desire for deliverance as to how far you will go. I'm going to say it again. It all depends on your level of desire for deliverance on how far you will go. If you really want to be delivered, and if you saw that Egypt was horrible in the context of it was horrible, you won't want to go back in it. But if you don't see it as a place of it was horrible, and you see it like this right here, well, it really wasn't that bad. I mean, they did give me three hots and a cot. You know, I they made sure that I ate. I mean, you know, they made sure that I had some clothes on, and you start compromising and you start looking at it like that, then you're not going to go on towards deliverance. You're going to stay in a suspended place, you know, dibbling and dabbling with back over in Egypt and then trying to come to deliverance. Back over in Egypt, trying to come to deliverance. Those are the type of people that find themselves wishy-washy. Oh, man, you know what I'm saying? You think they ready for deliverance and you done got them, you know, right there to this point where you think that they at a great place for breakthrough. And then the next thing you know, the jokers will go do something stupid, you know, something crazy, back over fooling with Egypt. It is because the mind has not shifted to the point to realize that Egypt is no longer any good. That Egypt is dangerous. Egypt is not a place to be. So then they find themselves wishy-washy. But a person that knows that Egypt is no longer where they want to be, they go on through that deliverance. At no matter what cost, they going to go on through that deliverance. Oh, man, it's hurting, but they going to go on through it. You know, even gritting the teeth. I got to tell the truth. Yeah, I got to tell the truth. I don't like it. You know, and this kind of stuff. What did you do? I shot that sheriff. You know, they're going to tell the truth because of the freedom that's coming out of it in order to take them to the promised land. And then you have to understand this right here. When you look at the stages of it, it's wilderness, it's Egypt, wilderness, promised land. Once you make it to the promised land, you don't even see Egypt anymore. You don't even see Egypt. All you see is what you endured in the promised land, which now, in the wilderness, which now becomes your testimony. That's why you're able to tell it, because it now becomes your testimony of what all you had to go through, the deliverances that God saw you through, is you now able to testify about it. Because you don't see Egypt. You see the stripping that came off of you with Egypt. You know, so your testimony be something of the sort like this right here. I remember, you know what I'm saying, going on a 30-day fast. And I'm praying for the Lord to save my marriage. I want God to show Quincy that he's wrong for letting me go and wanting to divorce me. But in the 30-day fast, I saw Delphine. See, that's a wilderness encounter. I've mostly forgotten a lot of what I dealt with in Egypt. I've forgotten a lot of that. A lot of times people have to remind me of it. Now, Quincy, he hadn't, because he's still stuck there. But, you know, so he could tell you down to the T stuff that happened. I can't. But I can tell you the deliverance that I went through and where God cleansed me. So that gives depiction of where you are. So my advice, we're going back, you know, to saying to you, Toya, is to get more of the deliverance. You know, don't be so quick to make no moves. Just chill out. Just chill out. Just chill out for a minute, because you got to work through that phase one. You got to work through that pride phase, because you in pride. Period. You know, you're set up in pride. Pride be that thing that makes you, you know, hold on to stuff. You know, that's one of the signs of pride in operation. You know, because pride just tells you lies. You know, pride gives such a false... Wow, it's raining. Pride gives such a false narrative about things that it makes you just lock in, you know, on stuff. So just chill out. All right. So, promised land. When they made it to the promised land, that wasn't a place that God designed to give them right then. That was a place God always had in mind for them. I hope y'all hear me. Your breakthrough is not a place that God just decides one day he wants to give you. But it is a place that God has always had and designed for you. God created a promised land called Eden. So his original intent... I'm about to get out of here. His original intent was that you be blessed. His original intent was that you be supplied for. His original intent was that you lack nothing. His original intent was that you even have your mate, your covenant mate. Did he not do all that in the garden? I gotta get out of here, y'all. Did all that come from the garden? Am I asking a question?
Yes, ma'am.
everything they needed to sustain them
was there.
Was in that garden, wasn't it?
It was.
So God's original intent was that you have everything or have nothing.
Everything.
That you have everything and some things.
Everything.
That you have everything and a little bit.
Everything.
God's original intent was that we have everything. So then, it was not your promised land. Are you getting back to the promised land? It's not a happenstance. It is a design. Come on, God. Come on, God. You done made me weak. Come on, come on, come on. I'm weak now. Alright? Give me strength. It was not a happenstance. Due to the nature of a fall that all of us has taken. Because all have sinned and come short of God's glory. Due to the fact that every one of us have sinned, the Lord had to create an advocate for us, which his name is Jesus Christ. The Lord had to make a way of redemption for us through a Savior named Jesus the Christ. And the purpose of that Savior was to get us back to the promised land. So, anything good happening for you is not by happenstance, but it is by design. And if you really know and understand God, you would know that it is his design for something good to happen for you. Okay, then I'm getting my strength is leaving for some reason. You would know that it is by design that good things happen for you. Do y'all hear what I'm saying to you?
Most definitely. Not coincidentally.
His plan. His plan. So let's look at Luke chapter 12. Let's go to Luke chapter 12. It's raining pretty bad out there. Luke chapter 12. My God. Flat time. Luke chapter 12. It's banging the eyes to focus in on this. I think I want verse 32. I think I want verse 32. Luke chapter 12. Closer to me so I can see it. Alright, so this is what it says. Fear not, little flock. It's Luke 12 and 32. Fear not, little flock, for it is. Oh, somebody read that for me right there, because that scripture gonna probably take me out if I can't read it.
Your Father's good pleasure.
Read the whole scripture.
Okay. So fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure
to give you the kingdom.
Read it again.
Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
One more time.
Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
So, God wants to give us what? Based on that scripture. The what now?
Kingdom.
Okay. But what is the thing that is going to try to keep us from getting it?
Fear.
Fear.
Mm-hmm. Fear. Fear. It says it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So the kingdom means the king's domain. That's what kingdom means. King's domain. Which means everything that is attached to the king. Everywhere that the king is dominant. Whatever jurisdiction the king is over. That's the kingdom. So then it is the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. So he's saying there is nothing missing, nothing broken. There is nothing held back from you. That was not my design. My design is to give you back everything that you realize the enemy has stolen. Everything that you see that he has taken from you, it is to give it back to you. So once you realize that something has been stolen, you realize that in the place of Egypt. You know, you have to come out of Pharaoh's bondage, out of Pharaoh's mind control, and to get into, well, am I still with y'all? Huh? Got a power surge, huh? Can y'all hear me still? Can y'all hear me? But did what first? My power went out, y'all. So, make sure y'all can hear me. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. You told us my power went out. Yeah, my power went out. So, it is the Father's. I'm waiting on my internet to kick back in. On this, let my rider boost back up. So, it's the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. So, what happens is, by it being His good pleasure to give us the kingdom, the king's domain, God has made a way of escape for us to have to get back to the original intent. You start realizing what Pharaoh did to you while you were in Egypt. You'll see it from that place. Let me see if it let me see. Back. Okay.
Hold on.
Did I knock y'all off? Hey. I think I cut everybody off.
I think I cut.
I think I cut everybody off. Yeah. All right, so what I'm saying is you have, you know, you start realizing the truth from the place of Egypt, because Egypt is a place of being brought out. Now, this is what I want y'all to, I'm going to help y'all understand that. I want somebody to tell me, what did God tell Moses to go tell Pharaoh? Okay. Okay. I want y'all to tell me, what did God tell Moses to go tell Pharaoh?
Let my people go.
Exactly. So I need y'all to understand that if I'm told, if I go open up a cage, if I got a dog and my dog is in the cage and I go open up the cage, that means my dog has been locked up, right? So when I open the cage for my dog, the first thing my dog realizes is that I've been locked up.
Right.
Because I'm now able to move differently. I now have a freedom that I did not have. And so, depending on the mental state of the dog is either going to be like, "Ooh, thank you, Jesus! I'm free!" and run in that freedom. Or either that dog is going to be pissed off. Because you had me locked up. Why did you do this? Why did you have me locked up? Now, out of those two scenarios that I gave y'all, which scenario is going to get the dog to the promised land?
The first one.
Say that again, two of y'all were talking.
Fact, he know he's free.
And if he does what? Keeps running, right?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
If he keeps running. But what do you think is going to happen to the dog if the dog sits in anger and mad at the master about having unlocked him up?
They'll lock him up. He can't move. Lock. He's still that gun.
It'll lock who up?
The dog.
Oh.
His mind says he's got it.
Bingo. 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 It's gonna now lock his mind up. And if his mind gets locked up, he won't ever get free. He won't ever experience freedom if his mind gets locked up. So, the best thing for the dog to do once it is freed is do what?
Run and don't look back.
That's it. Run and don't look. Because the promised land is in front of you or behind you. Which one is it?
Behind you. It's ahead.
It's in front. So if you want to go to the promised land, if you want to go to a better life, if you want to go into prosperity, if you want to go into favor, if you want to go into, joy, then you've got to go on. Now, granted, the dog has got to deal with the fact that it has realized that it's been locked up. That's where deliverance comes in. The dog has now got to be delivered because, let me show y'all what has happened. The dog life has been contingent upon that cage. The dog only came out at certain times out of the cage and then went right back in the cage. And depending on the type of master the dog had, the dog might have even got food put in the cage. Or either the dog was let out to step out to eat some food. It all depends. But at all times, the dog was under control because the dog, even when the dog was let out of the cage to go use the bathroom, the dog was in a fence yard. Y'all understand what I'm saying? God! So this dog is just locked up. In all elements of his life. God, I gotta get out, man. Hey, look, y'all, man. This dog was locked up in all elements of life. But now let me show y'all this. It looked like, hey, listen, do y'all want me to go any further and get out of here? Because it's about to turn up.
Go.
It looked like, to onlookers, that the dog got it going on. Ooh, that dog in a fence. Ooh, they got that dog in a cage. That dog got his own cage. But the whole entire time, the dog is what?
In control,
locked up. It's locked up. Y'all, we got to be careful what we be running around here calling blessed. Because let me show y'all one thing about a dog. I wish y'all were praying. Y'all ain't praying. Let me show y'all one thing about a dog. You really don't have to keep a dog in a cage, in a fence. Don't y'all know a dog will come back home?
Get some sugar, get some groceries. Shawana did it clearly. Never had to be tired. Cause it's kill.
They gonna come home. They gonna come where they are treated right. I have seen folk drop dogs off miles away and the dog come back. First he took one down away from him that didn't belong to us. He trapped one of them dogs from the people in the dirt road because we got sick of that dog coming up here. He lured that dog to him and put that dog in that truck. But Fussy. Oh, wait, yeah. I finna get him to tell y'all the truth. He took that dog down 189, all the way down to 189 somewhere and dropped that dog off. You know that pump back down in that dirt road? they gonna come back home. That's why they equate men to dogs. They say he'll go out there and sleep with whoever he want, but he gonna always come home. Cause home has a specific scent where he's marked his territory. And if he's marked his territory, any other dog that comes there knows a dog already lives here. And a dog already occupies this. From the littlest dog to the biggest dog, little bitty TK, which was a Shih Tzu, would go out that door and be marking his territory, and wasn't bigger than that, to let other dogs know he was here. And they would come up here looking for him because they knew another dog occupied this space somewhere. Where is this dog? I would see them come as close up to my door. Because they know there's a dog somewhere that's around here. Because that territory don't been marked by that dog. But black people are notorious. And that's the reason why I've changed my mind about dogs. And I'm waiting until I get straightened out to where I know I can take care of my dogs, because I'm going to give me 4 dogs, period. Black folks are notorious for tying up dogs. And leaving dogs on chain. If y'all was to go over to Honduras, it will blow y'all mind. Dogs are as humans in Honduras. Now, I did not see them let them come in the grocery stores and all, but them jokers walk the streets. You got to stop your car and wait for them jokers to cross the street and all. This is in Honduras, in Roatan. You gotta watch, you know, and let them cross the streets the same way over in Belize. Is it donkeys? Donkeys, I think it is. I think it's the donkeys. They are, you go to prison for killing one of them because that was their means of transportation. They would put things on those donkeys to let them they travel until Belize got big enough to start importing vehicles and stuff into them. So those things are, you better not touch them. I mean, you're going to go to prison, period. You're going to do some time. They have the rights. You just got to stop and let them go. Wherever it is that they going, they freelance, moving, you know, about and all that kind of stuff. So, but the nature of a dog is it's going to come where it's taken care of. It's going to come now. But if we don't watch, we will be calling what is prison. Oh, they got it going on. Oh, honey. Ooh. Ooh, they take good care of them. Ooh, honey, you some honey? Oh, man, it's good to hug them folks in prison. Folks living behind prison walls the whole entire time, but we from the external factor looking at it as, ooh, look at that, ooh, that's so nice, ooh, they built this right here, yeah, they built San Quentin, that's what they built, the prison. The entire time. I got a whole different revelation of that now. I ain't gonna be so quick to be, you know, I ain't gonna be doing that no more. I ain't gonna be so quick to be looking at stuff and I ain't doing that no more. No, I'm going on mute now, y'all. And when I go on mute, I be on mute. I ain't saying nothing unless I know the truth of the matter. Cause you be running around here, you know, You would be running around here in agreement with stuff and, you know, and celebrating stuff. and don't even know what be actually happening for real. That the mentality of why that took place was a prison. And you got the person in there screaming for help.
Somebody please help me. Somebody please help me. You don't see I'm locked up in here.
And you up in time. Girl! Ooh, honey, that man know he good to you. Yo, y'all seen all that right now they got? Ooh, they made them go, hell no, I ain't doing it no more. I ain't doing it no more. I ain't doing it no more. I ain't doing it. I confess it and I repent for doing it to anybody from now. I ain't saying nothing. I'm finna be looking now. Everywhere I go, I'm finna be looking to make sure. You need some help? Blink twice. You need some help. Watch it. Exactly what I'm talking about. I ain't doing that no more, y'all. y'all know y'all gonna take that to the bank. Y'all gonna go ahead and take that to the bank. Y'all know when I say I'm done with something, you can go and cash that in. I ain't doing that no more. I will not be looking at what folks got. Blink twice. You need some help.
You just gave the whole epitome of the get out that black man was locked up, and you can see the little tears. It was like, I'm locked up, get out of here. And the tears just falling down his face because he was trying to get out of there.
I ain't doing that no more. That's over with. I will not be looking at the external of nobody. Nobody anymore. And looking and you know, and giving praise and credence to things that they have, and you know, material stuff that they have. I ain't doing it no more, and I repent for doing it before. I repent. I ain't doing it no more. I ain't no telling how many people that I have looked at and thought that them folks was okay, and them folks was in prison. I'm so sorry, because I looked at the external factors of what was there. It looks like they're being taken care of, yeah. They being taken care of because they being controlled. That's why. They don't have a mind of their own. I won't do that no more. I repent, I repent, I publicly repent. I repent for everybody that I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Everybody that I have passed by and I've looked at the external factors and thought that they were okay, but they really wasn't okay. I'm so sorry, God. I'm so sorry. I won't do that no more. I won't do that no more. I'm not doing that no more. People be locked up for real. I ain't doing it no more. I'm going in as an agent of help from now on. Blink twice if you need some help. I ain't doing that no more. Man, we got so many subtle ways. God, please forgive us. Please forgive us. Please forgive us. We got so many subtle ways to how we do people and mess over people to this sad. And because we are so ignorant and we lack so many things, that we'll look at stuff and we'll look at people and think that them people are blessed and them people ain't blessed for real. Them people ain't blessed for real. I'm so sorry. I've done it. I know I've done it. I see people flashing before my eyes now that I know I've passed by. They weren't blessed for real. Control is not blessed, y'all. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry. Being controlled is not blessed. It's not. Being able to be who you are is what blessed is. Walking out your calling, your charge to keep, is what blessed is. Being able to be understood in your freedom, in your liberty. If you like brown rice and don't like white rice, that's fine. Not make you eat white rice. Not taking your voice from you. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why when you let a dog out of a cage, they go crazy. They just take off. Because you're bottling up all that energy on the inside of them and restricting them from their function, from their ability to run, their ability to enjoy. I got a different outlook now. That's all I can tell y'all. I had a different outlook now. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. There ain't no telling how many people I done passed that's locked up. And it looked like life was good for him. I'm so sorry. But it wasn't. And I'm so sorry. Covenant represents freedom. There are some restrictions out of respect that comes with a covenant. But a covenant represents freedom. It represents unison. May the Lord, some way, somehow, bring deliverance to everybody that's in bondage in any capacity. the Lord calls the prison doors to open, as the Bible says, and set the captive free. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Open prison doors, God. And command Pharaoh to let your people go. That we may stand fast in the liberty where Christ has made us free. And that we will be not entangled in them yokes of bondage again. Release the noose from around our necks that have been placed by the spirit of control, by the spirit of manipulation, even by the spirit of perversion, by the spirit of deception. Release the noose from around our neck. Grant us the ability to be able to run as you have purposed that we run. That we walk in the path that you have set for our life. That we're able to experience you shining in the light of your glory. That we are able to encounter you as the risen Savior, as our Lord and King, as our guide. We cast down false idols within our lives right now. Anybody or anything that we've made, God help us, please, on the wood side. Anything that we've made an idol, that we bow to, we repent for now, and we denounce those things. We ask for division from those things, and the spirit of submission be sent instead, that we be yielded to your voice and to your way. Your guidance, your divine guidance, become our portion. Open prison doors. Now, in Jesus' name. Anybody got anything, man? I'm stuck.
Amen. Much needed. Thank you so much. Much needed. Love y'all.
Angie, I pray that, I pray that the Spirit of the Lord, Angie, that the Spirit of the Lord will cause a great deliverance to come to you. There is a call there. There is a purpose there. You know, it's hands down. No doubt of it. But there are certain aspects that are still lingering concerning certain things that you encountered that needs to be removed by way of deliverance. You still carry this fear, even as it relates to Roderick. You still carry this fear, which causes you to make moves that are not always smart moves. They cause you to do things that end up putting you in dilemmas. because of this fear that you still carry that was lodged on the inside of you as it relates to him. May the Lord grant you the deliverance from the internal state of your being. Because that lack of deliverance is causing you more than you think.
Amen. I receive it. Thank you.
I'm praying for our deliverance, y'all. We've got to get it. We've got to get it. Anybody got anything?
Just thank you again for just letting God use you and you following through with what it is he had you to deliver to us.
Amen.
Just setting in agreement with you on open the prison doors. I just ask God, as you already have, to open the doors and set the captives free. A lot of times we're so shut in because of our past mistakes that we have made. And there's so many people who are just needing a fresh wind and a second time around. I just ask God to honor those who, like myself, who are seeking a second time around. Mm-hmm. It's like when we say in our childhood, when we get grown, my mama was trying to tell me, my dad was trying to tell me, if I know then what I know now, well, we've made it this far, and we've gotten a lot of knowledge about the things that we should and shouldn't have done. So as I ask God, like while we're on this earth right now, to honor us one more time and give us a second time around.
Yes, God.
Because there are a lot of things, like I said, that we know now that we shouldn't have done. Mm-hmm. So I'm just asking for a second time around. Mm-hmm. In this new life, new beginnings, new things that we're birthing. But a lot of it is so condemned because of what we have done and trapped ourselves in.
Come on, Pinko.
The things that we trapped ourselves in.
That is the word of the Lord. That's true.
There are some things we know we done. There are some things we weren't aware of what we were doing because of how we were moving. And we live a lot of days with, man, I wish I would have known this. Man, I wish I would have known this. So I'm asking God as he continues to pour into us his wisdom, his knowledge that he uses you to teach us. He shows us in our everyday life. So I'm asking him as he pours his wisdom into us to allow us to have a second wind with the wisdom that he has given us moving forward from this day on.
Yes, God.
Do not allow us to continue to be held back from our past. From the things that he already spoke of our lives, from things that he had ordained us when we were simply in our mom's womb. He already knew it. But to put us on that path that he originally instructed us to be on, to ordain our steps on that path that he wants for us. And a lot of times I have to go back and I ask God, you know, I have to make sure, because even though I'm asking for newer things than a second chance, I have to go back and I have to check myself and define details of what I'm asking for. I need to be sure that I'm asking God to walk on his path, and not because I want to walk on his path, because I want something out of it.
Amen.
When I walk on his path, I'm asking to let it be pure. Mm-hmm. Let everything that I might have wanted naturally be out of me. Because I know when I'm walking on his path, everything that I needed is already attached. It's already restored. It's already renewed. It's already more than enough. So when I ask for a fresh wind, second chance, my heart is clean. My heart is pure.
Yes, ma'am.
My mind is made. And I can live the life that God originally ordained me to live. And again, I'm just asking, open the prison doors. Set the captives free. Just one more time, God.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen. That's the word of the Lord. That's the word of the Lord, y'all. Anybody else?
As Tika was speaking, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And I feel all of that. And I needed all of that. My mind said, it's set. It's set this morning. And it's going to continue to be set. The gates are open. I have, my pit had 9 foot. And I had to master the pit and the keeper in with them. Mm-hmm. Somehow or another, she escaped. And that just brought my life. Until the way I'm doing, you know, my animal. And when I open that gate, she do take off. She'll run around. But eventually she'll come back home. And I've been in bondage a long time. Dealing with relationships that didn't mean no good to me. But after hearing the word today, it's time to let it go. Escape to what God has in store for me. And it's way better. Because if it wasn't, I wouldn't feel the way I'm feeling. And I wouldn't be doing the things that I know to do. It's all God. And it's hard to set your mind, but you got to do it. Things of the flesh in the world is not good. God is good. And when you reflect on that escape, That hit the hammer on the nail. Thanks for the word. Thank you for being determined and pushing for yourself as well as us and others to get that mindset and let go and let God. And it'll work out.
Mm-hmm.
God bless us all.
Yes, ma'am. Amen to that. Amen to that. Anybody else?
Just want you, yeah. We just want.
Lord, to take everything, man. Take everything I thought that I should have had. Take Hashanda, Mama. Shande Hisama. Take everything I thought that I should be. Yeah. Just take me on yours. Just recalibrate my life. Put my life where it needs to be. Set it where it needs to be. I don't know if y'all understand that you could be done wasted years of your life and not even know that that's what you've done, that's what you have been doing. God, listen, Father, recalibrate our lives and set the convergence where they need to be in our lives as to where we can now live out the fulfillment and the plan and the totality of what you have for us. Establish our goings right where they need to be. Father, release us from all the curses that have been placed on us, whether they are verbal curses, whether they are generational curses, whether they are mental curses, emotional curses that have been placed on our lives to keep us from the liberty that you have given us, Father. God, help us to not call wrong right and not call right wrong, but help us, Father, to see it in what you have for it to be, Father. Sharpen our discernment and grant us keenness to be able to see for sure exactly what's in operation. Not just see it in other people's lives, but see it within our own lives. Father, deliver me from bondages, God. Deliver me from places, Lord. Deliver me, God, myself, deliver and go down into the dungeons of places of Hades, places of Sheol, and deliver my feet from those places and establish my going and set me upon a high place that I may ascend into the higher heights with the Lord Jesus Christ, that I be seated at the right hand of power with him. Father, I thank you for establishing and doing just that, God. Open the eyes of our heart, God, that we may see you clear. Father, open our ears, Father, that we may hear you and hear you precisely. Keen and fine-tune our spirits that we may submit ourselves to what it is that you have for us, God. Open the prison doors. Oh, God, God. Oh, listen, from the pulpit, which is me, down, Father, to the congregants, Father, to the partners. Open the prison doors, Father, and cause us to be able to walk out free. Let us experience things in a new place where our eyes are booked, where we like, my God, I didn't even know that this was here. I didn't even realize that this was as beautiful as it is, that we're able to walk in that beauty, in the beauty of holiness, that we are able to walk in, Father, and experience things like we've not ever seen before. Father, that we experience abundance, we experience overflow, we experience prosperity, we experience favor and exuberancy, Father, that we just encounter, Lord, new opportunities and new blessings and promotions. Be God, be our portion, Father, we thank you, but it comes from a place of surrender. Take me, I'm yours. Take me, I'm yours. I thank you for bringing me out of Egypt. I thank you for bringing me out of Egypt. Thank you. Thank you. It's no longer my portion. I don't make bricks no more for Pharaoh. I don't work for Pharaoh no more. Whether he fired me or whether I quit, I don't make bricks no more for Pharaoh. I don't make bricks no more for Pharaoh. The Spirit of the Lord has now set me free. And whom the Son has set free is free indeed. So, Father, I thank you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Do I have any that are in agreement with me concerning this?
Amen. In Jesus' name. In Cabo Haya.
Amen.
Finish it, God. In Shabaha. Oh, Jesus. Finish it, God. Shit.
The prison doors have been open, y'all.
Yes, God.
The prison doors have been open for us to go through deliverance. Part of deliverance was today. part of this represents deliverance. Do anybody feel freer? Yeah, I'm just being honest.
Lighter. Yeah. Amen. Yes, God. Ha. Ooh, bah, bah, bah.
Did anybody get any fresh revelation that, you know, you just like, man, I didn't even know that till now?
Amen. I even heard God say it's the changing of the guard. Like you said last Sunday, we on the new authorities, no boundaries in certain areas. We foolish. Good God Almighty. Ooh, hasha.
Please.
Yeshabaha. Shackles are removed. Boy, it's running in my spirit. Etaha. Oh my God. Thank you, Lord.
And this is the thing. When it comes to changing of the guards, please understand what that means. That means that you are no longer holding yourself hostage. You've now surrendered to God. What's been holding is no longer holding anymore. It's not guarded by that anymore. So you're not guarded by fear anymore. You're not guarded by anger anymore. You're not guarded by poverty anymore. It's been a changing of the guard. You're not guarded by your past anymore. You're not guarded by that anymore. Hallelujah. Anybody got anything before we go? Y'all have kicked my butt today. All right. Y'all don't have anything?
Same God word.
Say what, Rico?
I just think after work is really on point in all aspects.
Amen. Glory to God. He's wonderful. He's my counselor, and I surrender all. All right.
Yeah, there's one more thing that I just heard. So I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say, prophetically speaking over each and every one of us, when the new things start happening, adjust your mindset to the new. Don't book against the new, because as you were saying, we're no longer guarded by things. The Holy Spirit said it's going to fill off just in. So when the new comes in, you still with your new. Don't fuck against the new, because there's a lot of things that if you come forward now, now that we done broke a lot of strongholds over our lives.
Yes, God.
When you don't recognize what's going on in life, just say yes to your will, God. Ask God to adjust your mindset to whatever the situation may be. There's going to be a lot of new. There's going to be a lot of good coming in. And God is literally about to open things up for us. And as it's raining right now, I hear the song, open, what is it? Open the floodgate of heaven and let it rain.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to know when that new comes in, don't get the budget. And guess what? And it ain't no months from now. It's finna happen fast. So as it hits, be prepared. already prepare your mind. Get prepared mentally. Get excited. Get excited. How can God move for us if we're not even mentally there, if we're already, we're just stuck in where we are? We don't have to pray on, hey, back in my day, man, when I had this type of money, man, when I was with such and such, man, I used to be able to when I felt good. We don't have to speak from that tone now because we're alive and we're able to embrace our new. Life didn't end back in our day when we were in our prime. If it ended, we wouldn't be on this earth.
True.
Embrace what is to come because it is here. And I still get, it's like I hear thresholds have been released. And that there were things over us that we just wanted. We talk about generational curses.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I read to this last week. We talk about generational curses. You know, we talk about things, we always talk about, like, you know, who might have spoken over us, like witchcraft, things like, we don't know what we were up against, but like I told Shrika, I think it was last week, there were things that I feel like a lot of us was fighting because people looked at us when our parents had us. Oh, that little girl ain't gonna be this. That little girl ain't gonna be that. That little boy. There were things that we have to battle through in our adult life. That people spoke over us. Me being one, that girl done had 4 children. Oh, she threw.
Mm-hmm.
She ain't gonna never amount to nothing.
Mm-hmm.
She ain't gonna never amount to nothing.
Mm-hmm.
The devil is.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I was just gonna say. Do y'all know we got powerful women on this line? Just powerful people in general.
Observation and get back.
Very powerful. Very powerful.
You know, piggybacking on what Pinka just said, a song opened up floodgates that haven't been on my mind heavy this morning, but she just made the statement, when it rains, don't get a bucket. The Lord said don't set a bucket out because that's limiting what he can do.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's on how much a bucket can hold.
Mm-hmm.
Pop your stuff up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, Apostle, as we talked about music, I know for the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've been hearing the song, as Lord prepared me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, I'll build even sanctuary for you.
Mm-hmm.
It just kept bubbling up in my spirit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The Lord is taking us through deliverance, y'all. He's taking us through deliverance in order for us to be, for our lives to be where they are supposed to be. Let's just say in many areas of our lives, we were on the wrong side of the track. But deliverance is putting us on the right side. It's that crossing over. You've got to cross over. Remember, you don't have to cross that Red Sea anymore. Now you got to cross this Jordan. You got to get across this Jordan now to get into the promised land. We going.
I didn't mean to cut you off
this
idea early. I apologize.
No, you're good.
We're going.
I've noticed something, Apostle. God is so quick on his response. I don't even think you spoke about acceleration, but it's like even with the acceleration, it's like you have to be very careful because literally I know for like the last month, there will be things that God is like bringing before me and different things like the earth that spoke about, such as like what Peter just said or whatever, and literally
Well, then the same day I hear you come right back and solidify and confirm it, because God is like, literally, it ain't natural. It's not a natural season we in at all, and we can expect it to turn over, just like Petey was saying, swiftly. I think Miss Angie was talking about suddenly. So it's like, as we posture ourselves, when I tell you, Apostle, and I be like scratching my head, it was like, you would have swore you was in a room with me. You know what I'm saying? But I understand that God, He's omnipotent. He's not missing in any shape, form, or fashion. But it was just like He was bringing that before me. Like, that's how swift things is. So to say that, like, you know, Miss Vicky was talking about, don't get a bucket. And then people was talking about, like, the things, don't be confined by the old, because what God is doing in this season. It's not mind-boggling, but, like, it supersedes the natural.
It definitely do. Ready to a new place. I don't know nothing. That's all I know to tell y'all. And I'm excited. And deliverance is our portion. So, I'm here for it. That's all I know to tell y'all, man. So, if you find yourself getting stuck, you know, please talk to me. You know, please talk to me. Tell me what's going on with you. Don't just try to deal with things on your own. And then find yourself, you know, back behind us. Everybody moving and you stuck back. Because you wrestling with something that's done made you stuck. But rather, you know, get to me and tell me what's going on so we can make sure that you move at the rate of acceleration as we all are. Because we headed to that promised land. We headed there. So, all right. Well, I love y'all. I pray y'all have a great day. The rest of your day. I'm going to chill for a minute. Y'all be good. I'll catch y'all later.
Love you too. Have a good day.
I don't wanna have to wait till Sunday. I don't wanna have to wait till Sunday. I don't wanna have to wait till Sunday. Yeah, he did it right there.